good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I don't know whether it's almost evening. It's humbling indeed, and it is delightful indeed to be back at IRMA. Close to two decades back is when I had this strange notion of coming to IRMA, which was actually laughed at by many. I was a mechanical engineer out from an NIT, and 90s was the IT wave, you know, so everybody was dying to work for an Infosys or a TCS or, you know, one of those large global IT companies. So I did work in an IT company as well. And neither did I like mechanical engineering, nor did I like the IT sector. So I said, what next? So I applied to a couple of institutes. And IRMA happened to be one that I applied to. Of course, this was what inspired me. I had read a lot, I had researched a lot, and I said, okay, if this is the greatness of the man, and this is the greatness of the institution, there must be something here, kuch to hoga, as Professor Bhatt as well says, kuch to hoga yahan pe, which is worth exploring at least, and I'm sure there must be a career opportunity out of that as well. And if I am truthful to what I do, I'm sure I'll land up in the right place, and I'll end up working as well in the right place. So, of course, people said you're leaving the sunrise industry. IT was at that time the sunrise industry. Ab sunset mein kyun ja rahe ho? Main kaha bhai ye to the sun never sets on rural India, isliye main ja raha hu. The sun is always there. Chali aage anyway. And of course, 2 years passed, and close to 2 years before we were to graduate, about 4 months before we were to graduate, I, along with about a dozen of our batchmates, somehow decided that perhaps the list of so-called designated organizations at that point of time were not the ones. While we did want to contribute to rural, while we did want to contribute to management, while we did want to contribute to development, now of course we have a much larger pool of companies and organizations which come to IRMA for placements, but at that time it was a little restrictive. So we brought out a brochure. We went out of campus seeking placements on our own. We printed some 1,000 copies of the brochure in our innocence, very wisely, actively. I was the guy who was leading the brochure design and mailers and everything. And we were very happy. We have bahut bada teer maar liya hai, kaam kar liya, theek hai. So about a month passed. We did give a couple of interviews. Somehow nothing much happened. And one fine day, one of these bunch of 12 people comes along and say, "Arre, prem patra aaya hai, love letter aaya hai. Kya ho gaya? Ye dekho, show cause notice aaya hai. Main kya, ye kya ho gaya?" So there's a letter which has been issued by the PRM coordinator saying ki you've been indulging in activities which is not right. And while we do understand that you opted to opt out of placement, which in the first place you did not ask us, chali humne ka koi baat nahi, go along with it. But of all things, aapne ek brochure print kiya hai, aur usme likha hua hai, students of Institute of Rural Management Anand, wo bhi koi baat nahi, aapne logo laga diya hai. Of course, it was out of innocence. We were not aware of the legalities and the, you know, the laws that be. Humne kaha bhai jo ho gaya ho gaya hai. So I then went flashback maybe a year and 8 months before, jahan logon ne toka tha bhai IRMA kyun ja rahe ho, main bhai 2 saal bhi nikal gaye, logon ki baat bhi nahi suni, naukri bhi nahi lagi aur show cause notice bhi aa gaya. And then the great man of course summoned us. So we had 12 of us. Some to ekdam nervous aur haath paon kaanp rahe. And that was the first interaction with him. Of course, I had read, we would of course meet him in gatherings like these, where it was not a one-on-one interaction, but it was him sitting and then we just watching him as a monologue and not so much of one-on-one interaction. So I said, chalo, ek to achha kaam hai ki inke saath personal audience milega. Of course, the setting and the entire episode was not the best ones, but chaliye theek hai, let's take it as it comes. So hame bulaya gaya, it was an evening, Dr. Kurian, the PRM coordinator, and then we were summoned ki bhai aaiye. So hum log mein se ek ladki bhi thi. So the very thing we did, of course, he was great, great at his humor. So in typical Shakespearean, the et tu Brute style, you too, tum kahan se phas gayi inke beech mein, chaliye ke liye main baithi hai. And then of course, Dr. Kurian, as many of you who know him and as if you've worked with him and you've interacted with him, for about 57 or 58 minutes, he spoke of everything except what the subject was. Ki main Switzerland gaya tha, humne buffalo milk ka powder banaya tha, hum log operation flood leke aaye the, humne grant money liya tha, humne aise kiya tha, humne, so all those stories, and you know, which is of course folklore and which he used to love telling on multiple occasions. And then I think the 58th or the 59th minute, he turns to the PRM coordinator अच्छा सर, व्हाट इज़ द मैटर ऑफ डिस्कशन टुडे? तो सर ऐसा ऐसा हुआ है, अच्छा क्या करना चाहिए, व्हाट शुड वी डू? ऑफ कोर्स इन इंग्लिश यू वुड आस्क हिम. आई थिंक सर दे आर सेइंग सॉरी एंड दे आर कमिटिंग टू द फैक्ट दैट व्हाइल दे विल नॉट वर्क विद द सो कॉल्ड डेजिग्नेटेड सेक्टर ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस, दे विल वर्क फॉर रूरल एंड दे विल वर्क फॉर रूरल इंडिया एंड फॉर फार्मर्स. अच्छा व्हाट डू यू फील, व्हाट शुड वी डू? आई थिंक सर वी शुड पार्डन देम. हमसे पूछा भाई क्या, हम तो प्लीज सर सॉरी सर बोल के. सो आई थिंक द मैग्नानिमिटी ऑफ द मैन दैट विद इन हाफ अ मिनट ही सेड ओके भाई आई फॉरगिव यू बट प्लीज डोंट डू समथिंग लाइक दिस एवर, कि आप किसी के साथ विश्वासघात करो. ऑफकोर्स आपने इन अ सेंस में किया है कि आपने ब्रोशर छापा और लोगों को छापा है, एंड सो दैट सेज इट ऑल. व्हाई आई ब्रॉट दिस इंसिडेंट आउट, विच ऑफकोर्स फॉर मी वॉज द ओनली इंट्रैक्शन ऑन अ वन ऑन वन बेसिस विद हिम, इज आई थिंक समवेयर अलॉन्ग द लाइन. Of course, the entire Amul story is known to all of us and to the entire world. It was a commercial, regulatory, political, social revolution of sorts, all rolled into one. And I don't think there is a bigger socio-economic developmental revolution which has happened anywhere in the world, and as a virtuous cycle. It doesn't depend on anybody for a grant or a dole or money. And rather than a farmer being given 5,000 rupees every month as a dole, it is the 2 cow or 3 buffalo or 5 cow or 10 buffalo farmer who day in and day out has a cash flow and is self-sufficient on his own. And of course, infrastructure happened, R&D happened, and everything happened along the way. So to that extent, it was in some ways the great culmination of various things, including technical, commercial, social coming together. And the fact that it could be done at a time when things were quite challenging, there was no Google, there was no internet, so you had to be resourceful, you had to go out, you had to meet people, you had to be jugadu, as you say, and then it was done, and it was done at that scale at which it was done. And of course, the tenets of IRMA as well, or NDDB as well, or all the cooperative institutions continues to be social economic development, equitable development, environment friendly, just, the triple bottom line and all the stuff that we normally talk about. So I was just deliberating and thinking while coming here, while I was, this was of course imagining first when I thought about IRMA 20 years back before coming here, and now when it's about reimagining, what perhaps has changed in the last 20 years since I passed out, or perhaps 40 years since the day IRMA was set up, close to 38, 39 years now. And what are some of the key shifts that have taken place both in the rural space as well as in the stakeholder ecosystem, which should somewhere force us to think as professionals and as institutions in the rural development management space. And there are 5 broad points which I would like to touch upon, which I would like to elaborate upon, spending maybe 2 minutes on each of them in the next 10 minutes. Point number one, I think, which is also very much related to the same story that I told you about Dr. Kurian, is I think now increasingly so, it is difficult to have a situation where it's an either-or situation. So there was socialism, capitalism, there was sector, non-sector, there was for-profit, not-for-profit. So there was a certain divide because both the political environment as well as the socio-economic environment was such that there was a divide for the right reasons. But now the world has become increasingly integrated and increasingly difficult to operate in silos. Rather, there is a lot of value which can come in by collaboration amongst the government, amongst the institutes, amongst the researchers, amongst the practitioners, amongst the managers. So somewhere there is a case for increasing collaboration, which we've seen in a number of instances already, a lot of developmental revolutions. We've seen the entire China story, the way it happened. Although it claimed to be a socialist country, but in the 80s and the 90s, while we were almost compared with China in almost anything and everything, including the Asian Games medals. I was just telling my children the other day ki hum jab bacche the to hum dekhte the ki ek din China ka ek medal upar hai, ek din hamara upar hai. Ab to zameen aasman ka farak ho gaya hai, right? So that's of course sports. But the same thing applies to economics, economy. See where we are, see where China is. It will take us at least 20 to 30 years to reach, I don't know, we may not even reach that mark unless we grow at a very fast pace, which of course the government is now working very hard at. So collaboration is the key, and I think that is something very important as practitioners, is my message, which I have also experienced as a professional. I have worked in a large Indian agribusiness company, I have worked in the food retail industry, I now of course work with a bank, and I have increasingly realized that there are enough altruistic, well-meaning people, and organizations eventually are driven by people. And perhaps 50 years back that was not the case. even take the example of the dairy sector, for example. In the dairy sector, till about 10 to 15 years back, it was only the cooperatives which would engage with farmers. Most of the private dairy companies would buy milk through aggregators. None of them wanted to engage with farmers. So they would say, bhai, kyun karein, paisa kyun lagayein, investment kyun karein. Now, of course, one side of it is to engage with them from a social developmental point of view, which indeed many of them have realized. The other is in their own enlightened self-interest. They say, bhai, if you want to maintain the quantity and quality of the source, which is the milk, you have to work with farmers, you have to invest, you have to get into feed, you have to get into fodder, you have to get into collection infrastructure. Unless you do that, you are going to suffer and somebody else is going to take the cake away. And dairy business, for instance, more than a marketing or a branding or a product development game, is eventually about sourcing. How good sourcing are you able to do? And if you are doing a 1 lakh liter per day facility today, you want to expand to 10 lakh liters, 2 million, 3 million, it's not going to be easy unless you work with farmers. So increasingly, industry is also realizing that it's very important to work. So these are just some small little cases, example I'm trying to give you. Ki on both sides of the table, there is ample amount of opportunity to collaborate. A lot of good things which the so-called private sector does, which the so-called for not-for-profit sector does, which the so-called government institutions do. And there is a need for a lot of such collaboration, which is something we should take forward as professionals and not divide ourselves into silos of any kind. The second big revolution I would like to highlight to you is technology. So right from digital, which could be artificial intelligence, machine learning, right from devices, from sensors that you have in the soil which help you to monitor soil remotely, custom hiring of farm equipment, for which you have models now where you can have marketplaces where people who have equipment can lease them out and people who don't have them can lease them in. So you have a situation where you have a large asset as a person leasing out but using only 20% capacity utilization and lying idle for 80% of the time, and at the same time somebody wants to lease it in, paying 800, 900 rupees per hour, not having access to it because you don't know where it is. So just like an Ola or an Uber, can you do something like that? It's something which is happening already. Drones in a big way, which are helping farmers to preempt lots of things which earlier they were not able to do. Weather monitoring, short-term, mid-term forecasting, which helps farmers to ward off a lot of things which otherwise would happen. So there is a lot of action which is happening in the application space, in IT, in digital, which is of great relevance and which in many ways is going to be a game changer for improving farmer incomes, reducing the volatility as far as their incomes go, mitigating a lot of the risks that they face, and right from IT to technology to whatnot, this is going to be a big space where professionals in the rural management space need to be increasingly aware of what is happening and need to be hands and feet on ground before the journey actually happens and you miss the boat. So technology, of course, Amul itself as a revolution, making SMP powder out of buffalo milk at that time was a big revolution, which was the founding laying stone of the entire Amul story as we know it. And technology, of course, manifests itself in various forms and shapes. So this is one broad piece. E-commerce, you know, this is another big leveler. An artisan, a guy who is producing a small little artifact, operating in a certain village in a remote corner of somewhere in Chhattisgarh or Madhya Pradesh or Jharkhand, can actually today sell his products anywhere in the world. You can have the right system, process, supply chain, and everything structured in such a way that you actually make a great business out of this entire opportunity. 10 years back, there was no way you could do it. You essentially had to rely on some or the other intermediary on whom you had to rely. And today, there is a direct channel where you can do this. And of course, it takes a lot of efforts to put in the management structure, system, process, so that you're able to do a good job of it. But there is an opportunity. So I think technology in general is one very big area. For instance, where there is not even a course in any of these rural management, of course, IRMA is the pioneer in that. I don't find there is even a course where somebody can do a technology management for rural applications or an AgTech, you know, AgTech is all about farm technology or food technology or supply chain technology or digital technology. So AgTech as a space offering a specialization, which in the next 15, 20 years is going to revolutionize the way rural areas are going to behave and act and function, is something which is totally missing. So I think that is something which we need to increasingly catch up with, and it throws up immense opportunities for socio-economic development the way we would never have imagined, similar to how you see what internet has done over the last 10 to 15 years, AgTech in general as a space is going to be interesting to watch out for. The third key theme I would like to highlight is increasingly consumers are coming back to their roots. So now there is this so-called fad about superfoods. There is something called quinoa, which we've been importing from South America at 1,000 rupees per kg. हमारे यहाँ बेचारे बाजरा और जवार 10 रुपए किलो कोई नहीं पूछता है, वहाँ से हम 1,000 रुपए किलो में किनोवा मंगा रहे हैं. काउ घी विच इज़ प्योर हैज़ गॉट सो मेनी मेडिसिनल प्रॉपर्टीज. बटर विच इज़ मेड द राइट वे सो मेनी मेडिसिनल प्रॉपर्टीज. इट वॉज देयर ऑन द कवर ऑफ टाइम 4 years बैक. तो हमारे यहाँ तो इतने सारे सो कॉल्ड सुपर फूड्स हैं एंड देर इज़ अ लॉट ऑफ कल्चरल हेरिटेज दैट वी हैव. देर इज़ अ लॉट ऑफ जोग्राफिकल इंडिकेशन बेस्ड वेल्थ ऑफ रिसोर्सेज दैट वी हैव which we have not even utilized, maybe 0.1%. And all that resides in rural India. That's where prosperity is going to come from. I happened to travel to a place called Modena in Italy. Modena is a place where all the Ferraris and the Lamborghinis and all the best of the luxury cars of the world are manufactured. To gaye wahan ghumne, to Modena mein, Modena se 50 kilometer dur ek gaon hai. To wahan leke gaye, so there is something called a balsamic vinegar. Jo Modena ka balsamic vinegar hai, it has got a certain characteristic and quality which is remarkable. So there were some Ivy League educated students who would have gone, who would have come back, and now they have set up these, in our parlance, farmer producer companies. Aur wo balsamic vinegar bana rahe hain wahan pe, and they are so proud about it. Wo say, bhai, yahan ka jo angoor hai, usko is agroclimatic zone mein hum ugate hain, aur yahan ke alawa wo duniya mein kahin nahi ug sakta hai. Usko hum is tarah se crush karte hain, is tarah se usko vat mein dalte hain, फिर उसको मैच्योर करते हैं 10 साल 20 साल 50 साल 100 साल और ये हमारी शीशी 50 यूरो में बिकती है वेर एज यादव सेल फॉर 20 यूरोस एंड दे आर सो प्राउड अबाउट इट एंड दे आर सो पैशनेट अबाउट इट एंड दे हैव मेड सच ए ग्रेट कंट्रीब्यूशन बाय गेटिंग फार्मर्स टुगेदर फॉर दिस इनिशिएटिव टुगेदर इट्स टेंस ऑफ हंड्रेड्स ऑफ मिलियंस ऑफ डॉलर्स एज एन इंडस्ट्री टुडे सो कंज्यूमर भी इस तरह की चीज़ें मांग रहा है हमें इसके लिए काम करना होगा ऑन ग्राउंड वी हैव टू डू अ लॉट ऑफ हार्ड वर्क देर इज अ लॉट ऑफ पोटेंशियल फॉर प्रोफेशनल्स institutions in the rural management space to do a lot of this. And this is just food I'm telling you. Isi tarah health hai, wellness hai, handicraft hai. I mean, time has come when people, and as they say, there are cycles, just like fashion. Every 20 years, fashion badalta hai. Ye ek naya daur aaya hai abhi, jo shayad pehle kuch saalon mein nahi tha, where people are coming back to their roots. Increasingly, Indian consumer and the global consumer is very passionate about some offering which is ancient, which is about a certain thing coming from a certain place with a certain story, organic food. हमारे यहाँ पर बहुत सारी ऐसी जगह हैं जो by default organic है, certification organic किया जा सकता है, उस पर 30-40% का premium भी किसान को मिल सकता है. But it needs some kind of a revolution, some kind of a value chain, similar to how it was done for the milk story, where you have collection, processing, branding, export, domestic market, infrastructure, cold chain. So of course, it is going to involve a lot of efforts. The social organizations, the government, the private organizations can have a great role to play in this. So this is the third point I wanted to highlight on there being a great opportunity in the consumer space, on people coming back to their roots. And this is something which rural management professional institutions should increasingly seize upon as an opportunity in the interest of sustainably improving farm incomes and prosperity and socio-economic development. Point number four, of course, the rural areas also have changed in the last 20 years or 40 years. We are sitting in a state which a couple of months back had the world's first solar cooperative. There are instances where farmers earn more out of these solar energy generated and distributed than they earn from their field crops. You do see a lot of people who are getting into sustainable practices because increasingly our country in many pockets has seen unsustainable usage of resources, whether it's agri inputs, whether it's water, whether it is soil. So all of these are some of the challenges which have emerged over the last couple of years. Many of those challenges warrant some kind of a systematic effort to tide over those challenges. And these are opportunities for professionals in the rural management domain to actually do a lot of good work, which as a science, as an art, is something which is missing today. So the entire sustainability story, the entire story around improving the livelihood of farmers, the way things are changing on ground, is something which needs to be tracked, mapped in a very systematic way. And that to my mind could be the fourth big wave or change which is happening. The fifth one and the last and final one, which is also related to my third one. The third one was more about consumers increasingly going back to their roots. Now I would like to come back to the thought process that increasingly there are many professionals and young people who are going back to their roots. I have many friends who have left their jobs and they are living in a small little town doing an ecotourism or doing an organic farming or working with small little farmers. So people do have the urge, people do have the aspiration, people do have the guts and courage to do something, but somehow there is no institutional setup to support all of this. And in many cases, I think many of these things need to be inculcated much ahead before time. So IRMA as an institution is of course serving post-graduation as a case in point. Why not set up a large-scale sensitization program for kids who are between 10 and 15 years old? Making them aware, sensitizing them to the realities of rural India, giving them information, access about the opportunities, how they can possibly, as responsible citizens, make a living out of this, as well as work in an altruistic manner also to benefit the villages and the rural folk. So I think it's a lot of those storytellings, engagements, working with students, motivating students, bringing everybody together to a platform, because the need and the urge is definitely there. It's all about putting it together. And that, to my mind, can be a very big opportunity. So that's it. So I think it's all about, as a Hindi film dialogue by the director called Rakesh Om Prakash Mehra, who incidentally also made Mamuli Ram 25 years back, wherein the key guy who plays Bhagat Singh says that koi bhi desh perfect nahi hota hai, usse perfect banana padta hai. No country is perfect by default. You have to make it perfect. And so is the case with rural. There are challenges, there are problems, it is not perfect. It's for us, rather than to depend as citizens of the country on the government, it's for us to seize the opportunity, work with rural folk. And as my daughter keeps telling me, ki aisa kyun nahi ho sakta ki Hindustan ke gaon west ke shaharon se bhi better hon. Why not? We have everything. We have the resources, we have the people, we have the technology, we have the know-how. To masala sara tayar hai, hum uski sabji kyun nahi bana pa rahe. So I think it's that role that we need to play as institutions and as professionals in the rural management domain, and the future is bright for all of us. And the end objective, of course, is sustainable socio-economic development of rural India. Thank you so much.